Hello, today I want to tell something about configuration files together with atomic updates, what the problems are and what could be possible solutions. My name is Thorsten Kuckuck. I'm distinguished engineer at SUSE. I'm also the senior architect for the SUSE Linux Enterprise Server and MicroOS, and I'm also leading the future technology team. So what is the problem with configuration files today on a Linux distribution? The typical way is the admin changes a configuration file. The distribution sometimes later updates the configuration file in the package. The admin applies the updated package. And now you have a conflict there. The package manager needs to get the changes the admin made merged with the changes the distributor made. This is normally in this simple way not possible, so there are two choices. Use the new configuration file, move the old away. The result is the system can be non-functional or insecure, or can continue to work. If you continue to use the modified configuration file, the system can be non-functional or insecure, or continues to work. That is the two options you normally have. If you look at RPM and how RPM handles configuration files, RPM has support for configuration files and the Linux distributor or the packager decides how to handle the configuration file. The worst case is the configuration file isn't marked as config at all, so RPM would replace it with every change. Or the configuration file is marked as config. So modified files are moved away as RPM safe and the new configuration file from the distributor will be installed. Files marked as config no replace are doing exactly the opposite. The modified file stay, the new files are written as RPM new. Depending on which kind of changes in the package required a change in the configuration file, it can happen that your service continues to work or stops working. And it's all not always clear in advance what would be the better choice. To use a real-world example, I think nearly everybody of you had already contact with etc login devs. It's the default configuration file of the shadow suite. And one option there is which hash should be used for new password. There are many options you can choose. They warn that DES and MD5 are obsolete and should no longer be used, but the default is the less secured hash, and that is DES. So as good system administrator, if the distributor hasn't changed the default, you should modify the configuration file and add a line encrypt method SRA 512 to make sure you will e really use strong hashes for your new password. Now you have a modified configuration file and the distributor enhances this package, adds another hash, so modifies the comment in the configuration file or similar things. So every time you update a package, you have to look for RPM safe and RPM new files. If you don't look for them, it could be that going on forward, new passwords are again DES encrypted and no longer with a more secure hash. So if you use the other one, if you have an RPM new file and you don't merge the changes, it could be that the service will stop working because the important information here is missing. There are several alternatives. Some package managers let the admin merge the files during the update. So that is really nice if you have a single desktop machine or a single server, but it's only possible in a non-interactive way, the update. Think about a big Kubernetes cluster or another cluster of 200 nodes or so. Do you really want to update every single machine by hand, merge the configuration files, it is very time consuming and very error prone. There's another solution, it's called three-way div, which is diving between the original one and the modified from the admin and the new one. But if all three files have modifications in a func, then it's still to the user to resolve that manually. So back to when the package manager lets the admin do it already during the upgrade. Now, atomic updates is something which adds another layer of complexity on top of it. What are atomic updates? Atomic updates are a kind of update that is atomic. And atomic means in this case, it's either fully applied or not at all. So if something goes wrong during the update, it should look like to the system as if this update was never be tried to be applied. And the update should not influence your running system. Why should your running system not be influenced? Only thing of important machine, customer facing, the customer is entering his new big order. And while he is entering the order, you restart the service because you updated the package. So the customer has to start from scratch to enter his order. And another nice thing of atomic updates is it can be rolled back to an old state. So if the new update fails or is incompatible, the situation before the update can quickly be restored. There are several different implementations. Nearly every Linux distribution has an own implementation. One of the common ones are user partitions. You have two, A and B, and you switch always between the one you are currently using and the one you are updating for the next time. For OpenSUSE and SUSE Linux, we use ButterFS with snapshots called transactional updates, where we create a new snapshot and then apply the update to the new snapshot and boot the next time the new snapshot. But they all have something in common. The services running does not notice that there is an update running, and they also don't notice if it goes wrong and will be deleted, removed, or tried again. And you need to reboot to activate the updates. So it's always a question, what is more important for your update, uptime, or the secure update of the system, because it's a remote system, it's an edge system, something you don't want to send a technician in every time something goes wrong. So what is the problem with atomic updates? That there is a next level of configuration files. With atomic updates, you have the configuration file in the running system, which may be modified by the update, by the admin. The admin applies the update, which may also modify the configuration file. And while you haven't rebooted yet, so the changes are not visible, the admin decides to modify the configuration file again because he got new requirements, he forgot it before, whatever the reason is. And now the admin reboots to activate the update. So during the boot reboot, we don't have a package manager who could apply it, but we need to then again merge the configuration files. And this is pretty complicated, next to impossible. And even if you think about rollback with configuration files, whatever, it's in the current form with the current package managers nearly impossible to do. So what should happen with the modified configuration files is a big question here. In this presentation, I want to follow up or explain our goal. We started with interviewing customers, speaking on conferences with users, the OpenSUSE community, other Linux distributors. And we wanted to define a new way to store and manage configuration files. During all these talks, the feedback was very positive. So less than 3% of the people said, we are doing it since 20 years this way, so it must be good enough so we can live with it another 20 years. But the absolute majority, the feedback was, please do it, change it, fix it, make it better. But there were also requirements from these people we spoke with. So the vendor default should be easy to find for an administrator, that he can look up what is configured, how is something configured, and that he can find out what he need to change. The best for this would be if all is in one well-known directory and not spread over the file system like user lib something, user share something, or something else. Also, they wish to see that something got updated, that they know that they have to look at their changes if they are still valid or not. And they want to see what they changed. What is done by them which changed and which is coming from the Linux distribution. And of course, the most important one is changes should be merged automatically as far as possible. So we came up with some concepts which would work for nearly everybody. They all contain that we have two directories, /etc and a vendor directory somewhere below /user. The vendor directory should be searchable via grep so that you can find options, whatever. And the whole thing should be seen as guidance for new software developers and packagers. Rewriting all existing software is something for the very long term goal, not for a short to mid-term. So the result we came up with is that etc should only contain configuration files or changes, which are either host specific, means they are only for this host, like which kernel modules needs to be loaded with which options, which kernel modules should not be loaded, what is the network configuration for this, or made by the admin. For example, which configuration or how for the Apache server be started, from which DHCP NTP servers would the NTP client get the time and so on. There are already some existing solutions. One common one is a three-way, as I already said. There can still conflicts happen which need to be solved manually. Another common solution is that etc only contains symlinks to the files in the vendor directory. The advantage is that files are always current with every update and always there in the right version as long as admin does not modify them. But if the admin wants to modify them, he has to delete the symlink and copy the original file to /etc and then modify this copy. And after every update, he has to check if the vendor made another change to the configuration file or not. Since this is now no longer under control of a package manager, he has not the advantage that the package manager will notify him, but he has to do everything at his own. And there is a systemd-like way. You have a vendor here where the default configuration files are, and in etc only the admin changes are. And this is a way we want to follow mostly. So, coming to the proposals. There are different kinds of configuration files that you always need to keep in mind if you want to find a solution, because since you have different kinds of configuration files, this also means there is not the one solution, but you need to look off which kind of configuration file this is, how is application using them, what should be the result. So there are at first the configuration files for applications or the system, the network, hardware. Common are key value style init or configuration files. That is very easy, as I will show later. They can also be in XML or any other own format, YAML, JSON, whatever else. Then we have some kinds of databases like etc, RPC, services, protocols. And in the end, we have system and user accounts, etc passwd, etc group, etc shadow. As you can see already, for all of them, you need different solutions. Key value configuration files are the easiest one. That's why we start with them, to have some movement for the beginning. We decided to do it like or similar to systemd. If there is a configuration file, etcapplication.conf, the application should use this configuration file. If this does not exist, load the vendor application.conf file and merge vendor specific.d snippets so that you have already one full configuration file with defaults, and then look for overrides in etcapplication.conf.d and merge them. For more details and examples, it's the best to read the systemd unit example sections of the documentation. That is really great documentation and stuff to read and to understand in detail with examples how this should work. So you might now think it's a lot of coding work, but in the end, it isn't. Many applications have already today support for it, even if it is most of the time not used by the distributions. Linux BEM, for example, has a configurable vendor directory where it looks for PEM configuration files. It looks in userlib.pem.d and it looks in etc.pem.d in this order. So you could already do it today without any coding change. You only need to do some packaging changes, put the PEM configuration files of every package in the vendor.dir.pem.d or userlib.pem.d and not in etc.pem.d. Same for this CTL. We have a userlib, this CTL. You can see that as vendor.dir. We have a etc this CTL.d. So we don't need etc this CTL. In the end, it's superfluous and obsolete. And there are several more tools who have .d directories. Aliases.d, ant.d, bef.completion, crony, con, depmod, dnsmask, dracut, grub, issue, locrotate, modprobe, netconfig, sudoers, and a lot of more. So all which is needed here is go adjust the packaging, think about how to do it correct, and maybe a little bit of coding, adjusting, enhancing, but the main groundwork is already done and there. Now there are many other applications which don't use a key value configuration file. XML, JSON, YAML, or some own formats. If you try this with XML, it's pretty hard. But if you know customization from Kubernetes and YAML files, you know that this is nothing new. There are already existing solutions, for example, for YAML files. It's not really easy to write an override for a YAML file. It's a little bit more complex, but it's already done today. So also nothing new. We just need to do it, that's all. System databases, these are files which are not really configuration files, but for historic, legacy, whatever reasons are being in etc for a very, very long time. So RPC service protocols, most of the time people today don't see that they are used on their system, but if you remove them, you will pretty quickly find out who all is using them. So there are also already solutions for it, also already done by several Linux distributions. Move these files to a vendor directory. The versions in etc, if they exist, only contains additional local entries. libNSS user files will look first in etc, afterwards below vendor.dir. And it's already done today by some Linux distributions. So libNSS user files is now SUSE specific, but other distributions have similar NSS plugins for glibc, which are looking in their vendor.dirs for these files. And it cannot only be used for RPC services and protocols, but for nearly everything what libNSS files supports. System accounts. That's the biggest problematic part. We don't have a solution for system accounts yet. You could do what some others already do and put PassVD group shadow in the for system accounts in the vendor deal. Normal accounts and changes are going to etc, and the GDPC NSS plugin reads them from both locations and merge them, but there are also many drawbacks. It does not really solve our problems. The admin wants to create system accounts, but with an atomic system, the vendor deal is most likely on a read-only part of the file system. NSS Compat and similar plugins don't work anymore because they don't understand or have support for vendor deals. It is very confusing for customers from our experience as the password for an account is an etc shadow, but they don't find the entry for this account in etc passvd. So they think something is broken, it's malware or something similar what is on their system. We had quite some different ideas. One was .d directories for passvd group and shadow 2. The OpenVault TCB implementation is doing exactly this. But if you look at it, then you will find or see that all tools modifying the data, the user mod, group mod, passvd, PEM modules to write back a new password are not able to handle it. And even for OpenVault TCB, the shadow seed has limited support, but many functionality does not work with it. So it's not really making it better, but more worse from a usability point of view. Then there are systemd sys users. In the first glance, it looked perfectly. The new RPM or that RPM has a sysusers.d configuration file, and at the next reboot, systemd will create this user. In etc, in the config, in the passvd file, as everybody else is doing and looking at too. That would be really great, but most of the time, if you want to install an RPM which needs own user, it needs them already during installation to set the file ownership correct. So it's a nice solution, nice approach, but for our problem, it's coming too late in the step. We would need the user already earlier. Now I several times mentioned a vendor directory. Several Linux distributions have them already. So there's user share defaults for clean Linux and several different packages. User share base layout, scale, bem.t, CoreOS for CoreOS container Linux and several packages like user share bem.t. WriteAble and etc WriteAble by Ubuntu Core, user etc by OpenSUSE SUSE. Some are using user share MISC, but that does not really fit with the file system standard. So we tried to come in an agreement with other distributors, but in the end, unfortunately, the FRS wasn't really interested in defining it. They only want to define common best practices. And there is no best practice, as you can see. And everybody else was saying, we have something, it's working, we want to stick with it. Now, in the beginning, I brought the example of login.dev. Let's look how this goal proposals would look like if we do if we use it with login.dev. Today, etc login.dev is used by the Shadow Suite, by Ute Linux, and by Linux Spam, the three packages which reading the same configuration file. But only one package can own the configuration file, so normally it's Shadow Suite. So if you update Ute Linux and it requires a change to login.dev, you also need to update the shadow package. That's already for a distributor, not so nice, but doable. From the admin view, etc login.dev contains encrypt method. You don't want to use this for it, but something else. So you have to recheck after every update that still the SRH 512 is used and not this for new passwords, which is a lot of work. So at SUSE we implemented for this reason libeconf. Libeconf is a library very flexible and configurable to pass and manage key value style configuration files. And Shadow, Util Linux and Linux Pem, all three support them already. You only need to compile them, link them against libeconf and configure the vendor directory at compile time. So how would the solution look like with libeconf? We have a vendor dialog in dev from the distribution provided. We have an additional directory login.dev.d in the vendor dir, which contains a snippet from Util Linux. So no need to always update the Shadow suite only because Util Linux has a change for login dev. It's now done by the applications when reading the configuration files. As user, you can create etc login dev, which would overwrite everything below the vendor dir. But that's normally not what you want because then you have again all the problems. Instead, you will create an etc login.dev.d directory with a random file name. Useful is to give a name which means something to you, like encrypt method.dev. And this contains then your encrypt method key with a new value. And every time you start passvd or any other tool reading etc login dev and using lib or linked against libeconf, you will have the vendor defaults and your encrypt method. And with every update of the vendor directories, configuration files, you don't need to care because you only overwrite one or two variables and that's all. Now the question was in the beginning, how can I see that the distributor has changed the configuration file? This heavily depends on your update stack. For OpenSUSE and SUSE, we use ButterFS with snapshots. So it's quite simple after every update to diff the old against the new configuration file. You can do that in an automatic way. For others, it depends, as I said, on their method. And we are currently developing a tool that would merge all the configuration snippets for login dev, for example, give you an editor to comfortable modify them, and then write the diffs to etclogin.dev.d for you, so that it is now there's no need for you to look in the system to find all snippets, merge them, and try to find out what the final result is. That is currently work in progress, and I hope that we can shortly release that too. There are several documentation about this. There is in my GitHub repository a readme about the background and the proposals, more detailed than on this slide. There's an OpenSUSE wiki page where all the packages are listed, which we moved already. Also, what the problem is, where the bug are, where the documentation, how to use it, and of course the one from libeconf. So that's for me, thank you. And we can go over to the question section.